Welcome to Talk of the Bay. I'm Christine Barrington. This little bit of musical genius is Dizzy Gillespie's Groovin' High, and it's a bit you'll be hearing regularly on KSQD because it opens a terrific program new to the squid but well-known to dedicated listeners for more than two decades. Gary Shapiro's talk show, From the Bookshelf, has been featuring the giants and the hidden gems of popular culture since 1999. You can now enjoy his on-air banter with authors, musicians, historians, and icons of the entertainment industry every other Thursday at 6 p.m. right here on KSQD. And so here to tell us all about it is Gary Shapiro. Welcome, Gary.
Thank you. I like your enthusiastic introduction.
I am the queen of enthusiasm here at KSQD. That's my job.
Well, thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, it's a joy. So we have about the next hour to take a tour through your pop culture wonderland, visiting past shows and looking forward to a new future right here at KSQD.
Wonderful.
Yeah. So you've sat down virtually with extraordinary people, to say the least. It must be incredibly enriching and pretty darn fun to do your show, correct?
It's such a gift. Yeah, it's really wonderful. I mean, you know, imagine that you're reading a book and you'd say, gosh, I'd sure like to ask the author this. And then I get to do that.
Right?
Yeah, that's what I've been doing. And it's wonderful because I love to read and I love to talk. So,
isn't that the perfect combination? I know. I love having a show here too because it gives me an excuse to talk to interesting people.
Yeah.
And it expands my world. So, given you are also a DJ on the station, you have two different music programs.
That's
Shapiro
right.
Shapiro at Large.
Shapiro
Mondays.
At Large, Monday at 11 a.m. Shapiro at night, Thursdays at midnight.
Right. Do you actually come in at midnight to do that show?
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Okay. So then you'll be coming in a second time on Thursdays, every other Thursday at 6 p.m. to do your show From the Bookshelf. And since you are an official music aficionado, you know a lot about music. How I want to do this show is, for the most part, I'm going to play a song.
Yeah.
And then you're going to tell our listeners how that song relates to interviews you've done and whatever comes to mind, because you're sort of encyclopedic. You have a deep encyclopedia bookshelf in your head. You always have a lot that you can say.
Okay.
So I make it easy on myself. I play a song and I let you roll. So here we go. Here's the first one. So this one should be abundantly familiar.
Oh, yes.
Tell our listeners how this relates to some of the interviews you've done.
Well, Country Joe and the Fish performed that song famously at Woodstock. I've had a lot of guests, actually, who were at Woodstock. And one of those was Barry Melton, who is, in fact, the fish of Country Joe and the Fish. And a sensational guitarist, a wonderful guy. He didn't write a book. I just asked him, you know, I found his email and said, would you be on From the Bookshelf? And he said, oh, yeah, I'd love to. That's one of the greatest things about From the Bookshelf, right? Is if you ask people to come on the show, they almost always say yes.
Isn't it great?
Yeah.
And his parents wanted him to be a lawyer. No, he wanted to be a lawyer, and his parents encouraged him to be a rock and roll star, right?
Yeah.
I loved that little turn. Okay.
Yeah. It was a wonderful interview, and he's a terrific, wonderful person. I really love him.
Is there another interview that you could associate with Woodstock?
Well, yeah, I've had quite a few good ones. In fact, let me think of all the people who have been at Woodstock, who have been on my show. John Sebastian was on the show, you know, famously leader of the Love and Spoonful, but then he opened Woodstock. I think he was the opening performer on Woodstock. And I had Neil Young, who's been on the show. He was at Woodstock.
Wow. I looked through your archives. I didn't see Neil Young there.
Ah, because when he appeared on my show, he had written a novel. This was before he had published his memoir. Under the name N.J. Young was the name of his. He wanted to see if the novel would, you know, soar on its own, you know, without the Neil Young name attached to it. And as it turned out, It did not. but it was a lot of fun to talk to Neil. I didn't particularly love his historical novel, which is called A Ship's Tale. I mean, but, you know, I didn't hate it. It just was not so great. And I found out that he wrote the entire novel and his memoirs later using a speech-to-text program. Yeah.
Did he edit?
Not all that well. And in fact, he writes emails this way, too. So I got, you know, usually what happens is I say, would you be on my show? And they say yes. And I say, well, let's do it this date. And they said, okay. And then on that date, we talk. And then that's the whole thing. But not with Neil. Neil was like, he sent me like 35 emails leading up to it. And then like the next day after we had recorded the interview, I was driving to work and my phone rang. Yeah, Gary, it's Neil. I was, you know, kind of surprised to hear from him. And he said, I'm not sure that interview came out so well. You want to try it one more time? I said, okay. So we recorded a second one, but we used the first one.
Well, so you got a couple of hours with Neil.
I did. And one of the nice parts of that was a kind of a 90 minute or 2 hour chat that we had that wasn't on the air. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'll air that sometime. So he was at Woodstock. Henry Diltz was really wonderful interview. And if you've never heard of Henry Diltz, you know his work.
You do.
Because he is one of the great photographers of all time. Now, he had a rock band at one time, and the band was produced by Phil Spector. But Phil Spector took so long monkeying around with the production that by the time the record came out, 30 years had gone by or something like that. And
someone had lost interest.
Yeah, but Henry Diltz was a friend of Steve Stills, and Steve invited him to come down and listen to his band rehearse at this rehearsal hall, and the band was called Buffalo Springfield. Mm-hmm. And so Henry Diltz was hanging out, you know, watching the band perform, and then he had a camera and he took pictures of them. And then a local magazine was interested, and so he sold these pictures, and that opened the door for him to become a photographer. And he became a very successful photographer. He was the official photographer of the Monkees. Any picture you see of the Monkees, he took. He was later the official photographer of David Cassidy, followed David Cassidy all over the world. He said David Cassidy was a wonderful guy.
It was like Teen Beat magazine that hired him, right?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
I remember Teen Beat.
And I actually once had the editor of Tiger Beat on my show, too. But anyway, so Henry Diltz took all these great pictures, and he told me this wonderful story. So he was at the edge of the stage at Woodstock.
Well, I actually have a clip. Can I play a little clip?
Sure, play a clip, sure.
All right, let's hear actually one of the voices of your guests.
All right.
Well, Michael Lang hired me to fly out from L.A., and I spent 2 weeks before the festival filming the building of the stage and all that stuff, and then of course, the concert itself and the aftermath.
What was your experience at Woodstock?
Well, for the first 2 weeks, it was kind of like being at summer camp. You know, it was like beautiful upstate New York, you know, all the green trees and blue skies and all these hippie carpenters building this huge wooden deck in the middle of an alfalfa field. And the young hippie girls would bring lunch by, you know, and stuff. They had a whole crew of kids hired to do all this work. And I would just roam around photographing everybody, you know, and one day, suddenly, there were about 20 people sitting up in the middle of this alfalfa field on the hillside, and it's like, what are those guys doing there? Oh, yeah, this is going to be a concert. I mean, you know, I kind of lost track of that fact, you know, and my reverie, you know. And then the next day, there was 2,000 people there, and then the next day, there was, you know, 400,000 people there. They were early arrivals, and the thing was they hadn't built the fences yet. But these people arrived days early, and by the time they were ready to build the fences, it was too late.
And so what was your impressions of the concert?
God. Well, it was amazing, of course. I mean, being the official photographer, I could stay up on stage or go any place I wanted to, and here was this huge crowd, which looked huge from the stage, but it wasn't until the end of the first day when someone brought in a New York Times and there was an aerial view. Then you went, oh, my God, you know, because you couldn't see that from that. So you could just see lots of people, you know, going out in all directions. But when you saw that aerial view, it just was, you know, I mean, we didn't know we were making history, you know, until we were into the thing.
Oh, that's great. Nice to hear that again.
Right.
Well, I have to tell you the story he told me about Crosby, Stills, and Nash. So Henry Diltz, the photographer, Crosby, Stills, and Nash had formed their band, but they hadn't decided what they were going to call themselves, you know, because in those days, every band had, you know, crazy names with Jefferson Airplane, the Buffalo, Springfield, whatever. And he took them out to this cool old house that he knew about that had this old couch sitting out in front. And he put them on the couch and he took their picture. And the picture came out great. And the guys were really thrilled with the picture. But he decided that night, the night they took the picture, they decided, well, we're going to call ourselves Crosby, Stills, and Nash. And the problem is that we're sitting in the wrong order on the couch. So could we go back and take the picture again, but we'll sit, you know, and as Crosby, Stills, and Nash? And Henry said, of course, let's go. So they pile in their car and they drive back. The house had been torn down. It was gone overnight.
Did they find another couch?
No, they just used the picture that they had originally taken.
Perfect. Well, that's a great story. And if you've just tuned in and you're wondering who I'm talking to and what we're talking about, this is Talk of the Bay for KSQD Santa Cruz. And my guest is Gary Shapiro. And we are talking about his show From the Bookshelf that has been going out over the airwaves since 1999, a long time. But now it's landing here at KSQD, airing every other Thursday at 6 p.m. And so we're doing a tour through, Gary, many of your shows, and I can tell from looking at you that you have something to say.
Oh, I was just going to, you know, say it's so nice of you to have me because I don't get enough airplay here at K-Squid.
You really don't. Not with two DJing stints and now a third talk show, but there is a reason people enjoy listening to you. You have a kind of encyclopedic knowledge of pop culture, and your show helps augment all these stories. And because you're a DJ and I know you love music, we're going to play another song and you're going to tell us what it has to do with your show. All right, here we go.
It's the time of the season when love runs high. In this time, give it to me easy, and let me try with pleasured hands to take you in the sun to promised lands.
That is just so good.
What a great record of all time.
All right, yeah.
All right, well, first I have to tell you about that record, and then I'll tell you how it relates. So in the wake of the Beatles, there was a British invasion of great rock bands. There was, of course. And among those great rock bands, my favorite was the Zombies. Yeah, sure, there was the Kinks and the Rolling Stones and all them, but the Zombies, they were so great. And their first two hits, Tell Her No and She's Not There, such great songs. And then if you went deeper into their catalog, you found all these wonderful songs, Whenever You're Ready, Leave Me Be, so great. And their lead vocalist, Colin Blunstone, such a beautiful voice. And all those, they wrote all the songs in kind of a melancholy minor key. It was so nice. Mm-hmm. And the band was never a success. They had a number one single and then a number four single and then a number 32 single. And then like nobody paid any attention to them. And so they decided, well, this is banging our heads against the wall and we're going to quit. So in 1967, they decided they'd had enough and they were going to record one final album and then disperse. And the album they recorded was called Odyssey and Oracle. And it's a brilliant record. I mean, it's right up there with, Rubber Soul and Revolver or Pet Sounds or any of those landmark albums of that era. And the thing was that the label didn't even release it in the United States. Only was released in England. And Columbia sent Al Cooper, the songwriter, producer, musician, over to England to scout new music in 1969. And he was over there and he heard the album, Odyssey and Oracle. And he came back and he said, you've got these, you own this record. You could put it out on your own label. You already own it. It's called Odyssey and Oracle by the Zombies. It's so great. And they said, oh, all right. So they put it out. And as an afterthought, they released Time of the Season. The song you just played is a single. And it became the biggest selling single of 1969. And they were anxious for the Zombies, to come and tour and, but they had already broken up.
They'd already gone their own separate ways.
Yeah, yeah. Rod Argent of the band had formed his own band, Argent.
Wow.
And Colin Blunstone actually just left the business, but he came back as a solo artist. And now, today, in 2023, the Zombies are still around and they're together and they're playing live, and that's really wonderful. And I got this wonderful opportunity to talk to Colin Blunstone. And the way it happened was I asked him And it was really a thrill to talk to him, because for me it was like, you know, talking to Paul McCartney. I mean, he was as important to me. And it's an amazing thing when there's somebody that you've admired for 50 years and then you get to sit down and talk to them. That's one of the great things about From the Bookshelf. And we had a wonderful conversation. I loved talking to him. And then the Zombies came and played at the Catalyst, and I went backstage and introduced myself, and wow, he was very nice. We got our picture taken together.
I love living vicariously through you. That's great. That's a great story. So let's go to another song and get some more stories from you.
Okay? Okie dokie.
All right.
We'd like for all of you to join us as we go back to the years, back to 1920, where the flapper era and
Prohibition.
And no drinking, and the excitement of the happiness of the roaring 20s. Fly with us in your imagination.
That's where the folk songs were written.
SOS, SOS, Captain, we are lost. Our ship is floundering in the sea by wind and rain. We're tossed. Lifeboats here, lifeboats there. Hear the shrieks and groans. The captain shouts, all hands on deck, and hear a mournful moan. Oh, how I wish I was in Peoria.
So some of our listeners will know what that's all about, and many won't.
Oh, yeah, I think people don't know the Smothers Brothers anymore.
Well, some do, but a lot of people wouldn't have known them from that song, right?
I love them.
But tell us, why do they matter?
Well, the Smothers Brothers, not only were they great entertainers and recording artists before they became television stars, they had a terrible sitcom. Did you know that? They had a sitcom. Mm-mm. It was before there was their variety show. They had a sitcom where Tom was an angel.
I remember that from the interview.
But then they had their famous Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour, which was a landmark show in the history of television. It was canceled in 1969, not because it wasn't one of the most successful shows on the air, but because they were determined to be topical.
They were kind of activists.
They were, absolutely. Yep. Television activists against the war in Vietnam, and against President Johnson, and then President Nixon. Mm-hmm. Well, I've never interviewed either of the Smothers Brothers, although I'd love to. But I did have David Bianculli on the show a couple of times. Yeah. David Bianculli, you've probably listened to him on Fresh Air. He's a regular contributor to Fresh Air.
And he's kind of a rock star to me. I was like, oh, David Bianculli.
Yeah, he's a brilliant guy. And he also wrote a history of television that I think is top-notch. And both books, on the occasion of publication of both of his books. He also wrote a book about the Smothers Brothers that was called something.
It's called Dangerously Funny, the Uncensored Story of the Smothers Brothers Comedy.
Yeah. That was a good show. And so I got to interview David Bianculli a couple of times, and I love talking to him. He's a terrific guy.
Yeah, he's cool. Well, I have a little excerpt just so people can get drawn into the world you created.
Oh, good. I'd like to hear it myself, yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing what they did in terms of music. And when I went back and watched these shows for the first time in years, now, the E! Network had repeated them in 91. But before that, they hadn't been seen since the Smothers Brothers were thrown off the air in the 60s. But if you go back to those for the first time after having seen them, it's amazing, at least it was to me, how many of the musical artists that I still revere I was introduced to by that program. But they were starting to lose audience in the final season, because in the first 2 years, the reason that they became such a surprise and instant success was because they did successfully straddle generations during the generation gap. So you had Kate Smith and Simon and Garfunkel on the same show, or you had Mickey Rooney and Betty Davis and The Who, and interacting, not just build in the same hour like you would with Ed Sullivan.
Right.
But in the final season, that's when they were having that, like, Donovan in the Round concert, and they were inviting the cast of Hair on, and doing more and more things that were aimed at the young generation that Tom wanted to reach and so identified with. So maybe they only lost like 4 or 5 million viewers. They were still in the top, 20 or 30, near the top 25 when they were fired. But I would have loved to have seen them ride out the 60s and, with the sort of clout that they had and the guests that they had and the connections that they had. When you can get a Beatle to come on and be a surprise guest on your show without any billing, that's pretty cool.
Tommy also has a special guest, too, and he'd like to introduce him right now.
Right, I have a Beatle.
Yeah, but it's not the kind of Beatle you would expect it to be. It's the kind of Beatle that you, I think you hoped it would be. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. George Harrison. Do you have something important?
Something very important to say on American television.
You know, we don't have opportunity of saying anything important because it's American television. Every time you say something, and try to say something important, they...
Clap. Cue the lines. Well, whether you can say it or not, keep trying to say it.
That's what's important.
You get that? Yeah. That is very important. Cue. Just a minute.
Wait a second.
Okay, cue the clap now.
I remember watching that show.
Wow, you watched it live.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I have to tell you something else about the Smothers Brothers and the Beatles. So 5 years after they were fired, they played the Troubadour. It was their first, you know, kind of comeback performance. And I went to the early show at the Troubadour in Los Angeles. Paul Newman was in the audience.
Wow.
I said hello to him.
Wow.
He looks exactly like me. It was uncanny. But those of you in the radio audience can't see me, but... But anyway, the Smothers Brothers were terrific, and it was lovely, and I left. That night, at their late show, John Lennon and Harry Nilsson came, and that's the famous night that John Lennon was thrown out of the Troubadour for being a jerk. So that was as close as I came to.
All roads lead to the Beatles, with Gary Shapiro. And in case you've just tuned in, you are listening to Talk of the Bay on KSQD Santa Cruz. My guest is Gary Shapiro, host for a new program to the Squid, From the Bookshelf, airing every other Thursday at 6 p.m., but it's been on the air for a very, very long time, since 1999.
It was actually on the air earlier than that. It was
really?
Created by Billy Harris, who was a wonderful person, and she hosted Saturday's Child here on KSQD
right.
for many years.
She just passed away, right?
Yes, and she was doing a show on KUSP called From the Bookshelf, where she had people coming in and reading short stories and things that on Sunday night. And she said, Gary, darling, would you please come in and read a story? So I did. And she said, yeah, that's wonderful. You have to come back again. And eventually I came back again every week and took over the show. And so.
Wow. And it's just been sort of swimming its way through the Santa Cruz airwaves on KUSP and then KSCO.
Yes, so KSCO, mm-hmm. after KUSP folded in 2016, KSCO picked up the show and they air it on Monday nights. It was really nice of them to have the show. I'm grateful to them.
And now they are leaving the airwaves and somebody else has picked you up. Isn't
yes.
it nice to know that you're wanted?
It is. It's very, very, very nice.
Well, we're going to hear more about Gary Shapiro's brilliance from the Bookshelf. But first, we're going to take a short break and we'll be back with more from Talk of the Bay.
Hey Jude, don't be a fool. Take a sad song and make it better. The minute you let it into your heart, then you can start to make it better. Hey Jude.
All right, well, welcome back
King.
To Talk of the Bay, yeah, with Gary Shapiro. And yes, it's the King, Gary. And I'm playing songs that relate to shows that you have done from the Bookshelf. And tell us about how this one relates to interviews you have done. And this is going to sort of like, you know, go in several different directions, right?
Yes, because I not only have done many, many shows about the Beatles, and we can talk about that, but I've also done a couple of really great shows about the King. In fact, one of my first interviews was Peter Guralnick. Peter Guralnick is the definitive biographer of Elvis. He's written a 2-volume wonderful book about Elvis. And actually, Peter Guralnick, when he was a writer for Rolling Stone magazine, was the first person to really tell me, through his writing, the story of Elvis. I think it was in 1969 or 68. He wrote an article that was, you know, a review of the current Elvis album, whatever it was. But he took the opportunity to really tell the Elvis story, which I hadn't really known until I read that. I mean, I always knew who Elvis was and always right. admired and loved him. But the Elvis story is such a fascinating one.
Right. And how did that impact you?
Well, you know, I've always, you know, been a fan. But then I started to seek out, you know, the Sun Sessions, which weren't so easy to find then. It's not like there was a Sun Sessions album then. You had to go get every Elvis album from the early years, and there was like two or three Sun Sessions on each one. And I started to really collect and listen and understand Elvis rather than just admire him as the current, you know, recording artist that he was then. So I've had Peter Guralnick on the show. I've also had the wonderful opportunity to talk to Scotty Moore. When Elvis first went into the recording studio in 1954 to record That's All Right, Mama, which was the first rock and roll record ever made. You know, we don't know when the first painting was made or the first sculpture, but we know when rock and roll was born. And it was at Sun Records in 1954, July 4th, 1954. And Scotty Moore was the guitarist on that record. And he was a guest on my show. He's since passed away, but I had a great time talking to him. I also had, also no longer with us, George Klein, who was the best man at Elvis Presley's wedding. Yeah, one of those great people. I've actually also talked to Peter Guralnick not only about Elvis, but about Sam Phillips, the man who discovered and recorded
Right.
Elvis.
Have you visited Sun Studios?
I've never visited Sun Studios, but I have been to Graceland.
Yeah.
Yeah, I went to Graceland. Yeah. Many years ago, I went to Graceland. And they had, that was before, I don't know how they do it now, but they didn't have an audio tour. They had these little people. I mean, they were
way
little.
More fun when the little people do it. Yeah, they're 2 inches high.
All of them were like related to Elvis in some way. Like his whole family was employed there. And each room had a person that knew nothing about anything except that room that they were standing in. Welcome to Graceland today. We hope you learned some things about the king that you did not already know.
And I bet you did.
This is the TV room, so named for the three TVs that you see here. Elvis used to watch three TVs, inspired by President Lyndon Baines Johnson, who watched three newscasts at once. I don't know what Elvis needed three TVs for, but yeah, so I went to Graceland. So I've always been a fan of Elvis. I still love him. And the Beatles, Hey Jude was the song you played.
Yes, it was.
I've had many opportunities to do shows about the Beatles, and that's been great. And I've never had any of the Beatles themselves.
No?
I've gotten pretty close. I had Cynthia Lennon. I think the only interview Cynthia Lennon did to promote her book was with me. And I was in, at the time that I recorded the interview, I was in France, and she was in Spain. And I sat on the floor of this little apartment in France and recorded this interview with her, and she was so lovely. It was really, really, really fun to talk to her. And I talked to Jeff Emmerich, who was the chief engineer on the Beatles recordings.
Wow.
Yeah. I talked to...
What a nice job to have, huh?
Yeah, I've talked to Mark Lewison, who's like the official Beatles historian, and almost every other person that's written books about the Beatles, some that I couldn't stand and some that I really liked.
Well, it's got to be that way.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, there was a guy, and I don't want to say his name, Howard Soons, and he wrote a book. He wrote a book about Paul McCartney that a lot of people are, I don't know, they have something invested in tearing down Paul McCartney, and I don't know why exactly. And he is one of those people, and I took offense at his book.
Did you let him have it?
I kind of did. Yeah, I said, when you say there's a sense that Paul McCartney is desperate for a hit. I mean, what do you mean there's a sense? Who has this sense?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it was me. Yeah, it was what he said. Well, I got a chance to talk to Philip Norman, who I think wrote the best biography of the Beatles, which is called Shout. But the only problem with Shout, it was published in 1981, right after John's death, and I think there was a rush to get it out. And I think that book was unkind to Paul McCartney and kind of began that kind of lionization of John.
Yeah, didn't he subsequently write a biography of Paul McCartney and kind of made up for it and apologized?
He did. And when I first talked to him, he hadn't done that yet. Mm-hmm. And I said, I love Shout, but I think you were unkind to Paul McCartney. And he said, you're right, I was, and I'm going to make it up to him.
Wow, so maybe you encouraged...
I'm the one.
You're the one. You are the one.
All things revolve around me.
Okay, so it's just amazing all the lives that you have intersected with.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm thinking now back to... You really got your start very early being fascinated with pop culture. Can you tell people a little bit about...
Oh, gosh. I guess I was... I mean,
because you are a part of all these interviews. Yeah?
I guess I've always been, from the time I was a little kid. Obviously, I listened and absorbed the popular culture that was happening then, but I also was fascinated with the popular culture of the past. You know, I had like a wind-up Victrola that this friend of ours had, and I would sit there and play 78s, just, you know, you just stare at them spinning around, you know, and listen. And I had a record collection before there were the Beatles. I already had a record collection, you know. I had 45. My first record that I ever bought, or that I made my dad buy for me, was a 45 of Pocket Full of Miracles by Frank Sinatra. Right. So like I was always interested in that stuff. And so when my friends, you know, were listening to Cream and Hendrix, which I liked as well, you know, I was listening to Bing Crosby and Gene Austin and Fred Astaire and stuff like that.
Even though this show is really a joy for you to do, you're not making any money, it seems like you're really living out a very important part of your deepest being and kind of almost meant to do something like this.
Well, that's nice to hear. Well, I really enjoy it. It's really fun to, I try really hard not to talk too much. You know, I want want my guests to do all the talking, but I also don't want a kind of a, you know how you books, when people write books, they're on a book tour and they go around and they're on all the shows and they say the same thing over and over again. So I really try hard not to ask any questions that they've already been asked. And I want to have a conversation rather than a, you know, tell us about your book. I mean, they're also used to doing a 10-minute thing or a 6-minute thing where they talk about their book. And I want to have a more expansive canvas to talk.
Yeah, you get personal and intimate, and I learn many interesting things, which we're going to get to a little later.
My favorite thing is when people say, oh, no one's ever asked me that before.
Bingo. Yeah. Ding, 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 ding. You have a little sound effect. Ding, 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 ding. Okay. I'm going to keep along my job here of playing songs and having you share stories.
I thought love was only true in fairy tales and for someone else, but not for me. Love was out to get me. That's the way it seemed. Disappointment haunted all my dreams. Then I saw her face. Now I'm a believer. Not a trace.
So we're believers. We're here dancing in the studio and having music is just so great. Like, I love interviewing you because it gives me an excuse to play music.
This. Yeah. Yeah, from the Fab Four to the Prefab Four.
That's the pre. Tell us about these guys. I think they're pretty special.
I love the Monkees. And you know, the thing is, today people, I think people love the Monkees now too, but there was a sort of a period where the Monkees got a bad rap because they didn't play their own instruments on their records. But you know what? The Birds, the Association, the Mamas and the Papas, the whoever, the Love and Spoonful. Nobody played their own instruments on their records. They were all played by the same group of musicians, the Wrecking Crew, that played on everybody's record.
That
the Beach Boys
too.
Beach Boys too. So the Monkees didn't always play their own instruments, but you know, when the cast of Gilligan's Island was hired to be on Gilligan's Island, they didn't actually have to go live on a desert island for the rest of their lives. But when the actors who played the Monkees were hired to play a rock and roll band called the Monkees, they actually became the rock and roll band called the Monkees and remained the Monkees for the rest of their lives. And that's an incredible thing. And the music that they made stands tall. It's as good as any rock band.
That's right. That was a great song.
Yeah,
we were jiving right along. And so who have you interviewed? You've had Michael Nesbitt on, and he's a local man.
He was. Yeah, he's passed away.
He just passed away.
Yeah, Mike Nesbitt. And it was really fun to have him on. He wrote a book, and he didn't want to talk about the Monkees. In fact, if you were going to read a book by one of the Monkees, how much of the book would you want to be about the Monkees? 75%? So Nesbitt's book was about 2% about the Monkees.
Well.
And he was not interested in talking about the Monkees, so I had to find a way to get him to talk about the Monkees.
And did you pin him down?
Yeah, I found a way. I found a way. Because at that time, the Beatles had just released Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band's 50th Anniversary Edition, which was a beautiful box set that Giles Martin had compiled. And it contained, among other things, a Blu-ray that had this little video that they had made, you know, a little film that they had made for A Day in the Life. And Mike Nesbitt is in that film. So I said, how did you happen to be in this film? And therefore, I was able to get kind of behind him and talk about, you know, the 60s. And of course, then he had to say that he was in the Monkees. And then we talked Monkees, which was really fun. And I was so grateful to have him on the show because he also didn't want to do any interviews. But he granted me one, which was very nice.
He's an interesting man. David Bean, who is a DJ at the station, he's on the board of directors, has some really interesting stories about him as well. And the link between him and liquid paper.
That's right. His mother invented liquid paper. And that was, she made a fortune, and that was his fortune that she gave him to, you know, basically create the music video. He had the idea for MTV before there was an MTV. And it was he who kind of led to the creation of MTV. And you know, he was an innovative guy. I also have had books about the Monkees and on the show, and I love talking about them and listening to their music. They were great.
Well, you passed the test. I played the song. You came up with the right answer. All right. And in case you've just tuned in, this is Talk of the Bay on KSQD Santa Cruz. I'm Christine Barrington, and my guest is Gary Shapiro. We are highlighting excerpts and songs and stories from his marvelous talk show, From the Bookshelf, which has been on the air for a very, very, very long time and is now landing here at the Squid every other Thursday at 6 p.m.
It's also been a podcast for a long time, too, before
That's
anybody
right.
else was podcasting. Now everybody's podcasting and no one is pod listening.
You're one of the originals.
Yes.
Everyone's casting, nobody's listening.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
a good. How could we listen to all the great content that's going
it's
out
a lot,
there? But we
yeah.
do love to put it out, don't we?
Yeah.
So I'm going to play another song.
Okay.
And
I like songs.
Oh, aren't they great?
Lips are sealed.
And apparently our lips are not sealed
because
we're here talking.
Mine are unsealed.
All right, tell us about
Lips Unsealed was the name of her book.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
perfect.
Yeah, Belinda Carlisle. Okay, I have to tell you this one. So the nice thing about doing a program like From the Bookshelf is that publishers and publicists send me books practically every day and ask me to interview the authors, which I can't do because, you know, it's just only on...
You don't live in a multidimensional reality?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I don't ever, ever, ever have a guest that has written a book unless I've read their book.
Thank God.
Yeah, I don't want to talk to them Robert Klein, the great comedian, told me once that he wrote a book, which was a very good book. And he told me that Larry King, the famous radio interviewer and television interviewer, never read a book, but he never even looked at the book. Until 2 seconds before he came on the air, Robert Klein says, he'd glance at your book and then he'd ask you incisive questions like, why the raised lettering, Robert? But so
gives
I
always, hope to all of us who have grand ambitions but not enough time to read.
Yeah, so I read it all. And they asked me if I would interview Belinda Carlisle. So that was like not one that I sought out, but the publisher came to me and I said, well, that's so much fun. Yeah, I'd love to interview her. Then I read her book and I thought, oh my God, she's not smart. She's dumb. It's a terrible book. I didn't like the book, and I thought, it's not going to be any good. And how will I talk to her if I didn't like her book? She's just a delightful person. We had the most marvelous conversation. It was really fun. It was in the middle of the night. She was in France, and I was here in Santa Cruz. So it was like 1 o'clock in the morning that we did the interview. And I had so much fun talking to her. She was absolutely delightful and honest. And when I confronted her with some of the things that were inconsistent in her book, she laughed.
So apparently your talent is talking and singing and not writing.
Not writing.
All right.
Yeah. I particularly was interested in some of the intimate things that she exposed in the book. And then she recorded an audio book of it. And I said, was that difficult, you know, to... It's one thing to write things, but is it difficult? You know, and she goes, oh my God, that was the worst. I was so embarrassed. And she also posed for Playboy. And I asked her about that. And I said, you know, nowadays, if somebody Googles you, the first thing that comes up is an image of you, you know, naked from Playboy. And what do you think about that? She goes, well, I'm proud of those pictures. I think I looked good
She's
that
like,
day.
I look hot, man. Yeah. Yeah. Like, well, I'm glad that she feels good about it. That's
yeah.
what matters.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's go to our next surprise song.
Okay.
My doll is as dainty as a sparrow. Her figure is something to applaud.
Where will you
she's
look?
She's narrow as an arrow.
I stumped him.
And she's broad.
You've interviewed her.
We're abroad.
And you really like her.
Should be broad.
Florence.
Oh,
it's Florence Henderson.
Pounds of fun. That's my little
I
honey
love this
bun.
Song. I do like Mitzi Gaynor better, though. But good for her. You know, I learned a lot listening to this interview. She's had an incredibly wide breadth of
yes,
career.
Yes, Florence Henderson. Mm-hmm. She was the last original Laurie in Oklahoma, the last one of the original company. You know how they replace actors?
Yeah.
And so she was chosen by Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein to play Laurie in the last official Oklahoma for the original run. And, of course, most people know her as the mom on the Brady Bunch. And I know her not only because I have admired her for many years as a performer, but I knew her. I know her. She's no longer living, sadly. But when I was in high school, I dated her daughter.
Oh.
And she was many years later, after that had happened, I was getting ready to go to work one day, and I was going to tape something on my VCR. So I'll tell you when this happened, the VCR days. And and there was a game show that was on TV. It was called Tattle Tales, and it was hosted by Bert Convy. And it was a show, it was kind of like the Newlywed Game, where you had to predict how your partner would answer the question, and they were in a soundproof booth. It was Celebrity Mother and Daughter Week, and my old girlfriend, Barbara, and her mother, Florence Henderson, were the guests, among others, on this show. And I said, oh, I have to tape this. So I put it in a tape, and I recorded it, and then I left and came back. And it was like midnight when I was watching it. And Bert Convy asked, do you remember the first boy your daughter fell in love with? And Florence Henderson came on. She goes, well, I don't know if I should mention this little louse's name on television, but it was Gary Shapiro.
Oh.
And then it was the winning answer, and all the lights went up. Had Bert Convy said, hello, Gary Shapiro. So that was really funny. But so
did anyone you know see it?
My wife's grandmother saw it. And she said, you know, I was watching television the other day, and I'm sure they mentioned your name.
This is a $300 question. It is for you. If I can find it, here it is. Mothers, oh, you got to think now. Can you name the very first boy your daughter fell in love with? Yes or no? Goodbye. Tough question. Wow. Okay, Barbara, what do you think? What will your mom say?
Well, I'm thinking in terms of a little older than these girls are, but I think she's going to say yes.
Yeah?
Definitely.
A little older before you had your first real love, you think?
Yeah.
Yeah? What was his name? Do you remember?
Oh, yeah, but I'm not telling.
You're not going to tell?
I'm so glad I said yes or no.
Okay. Yeah, and she remembers, too.
Mm-hmm. But she'll tell you.
Okay, she will? All right, good. The answer is yes. Here she comes. Florence, what do you think? It's a yes or no question, of course. Can you remember?
I don't think I should mention this little louse's name on television, to tell you the truth. No, actually, he was a very sweet boy, and I hope I'm thinking of the right one. But I would say Gary Shapiro.
But that's not the question. The answer is, can you remember yes or no?
Oh, that's terrible. Oh, now I really said it. Don't kill me. Can you? Oh, please. I misunderstood. Yes.
That's right. You're right. You're all right. You split the 300 three ways, but time is up. The red section wins it. I will come back, give them money, and hello, Gary Shapiro.
I wrote a letter to Florence, and I said I was going to have to sue her because the firm that I was with was going to fire me when they found out I'd been involved with the show people.
Ah. Well, I have a little excerpt because I know you really like her a lot.
And so good.
I
let's hear
a little.
Again.
Let's hear a little Florence Henderson.
I started doing television pretty early in my career. My first TV appearance was actually off camera on the Ed Sullivan Show when I was in Wish You Were Here. But then I went on to to appear on the Ed Sullivan Show, and I became a regular on the Jack Parr Show, and went on to Johnny Carson, and I did every variety show known to man, and every game show, and you know, live television is very exciting. I mean, you fly by the seat of your pants, you know, that experience, I think, stands you in very good stead if you want to have a long career.
You know, your career kind of bridges some eras in American entertainment, and you knew some of the really famous people of the previous era. I mean, I saw you on a Bing Crosby show. You were doing a commercial for...
That was one of the first things. Yes, I did Oldsmobile.
Yeah.
Commercial. That was years ago. Yeah, I mean, it's just interesting how my career developed. And then later, when Bing was hosting Hollywood Palace, I was a guest star on the show. So it's just, you know, having done commercials on a Jerry Lewis special, which he was directing and never really finished the dress rehearsal, but then to work clubs with him and get to know him on that level, and Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin and all these people that I got to know and work with, my gosh, I've been very blessed, I think.
Well, that does sound like a blessed life.
I have to tell you more about Florence Henderson. She was such a wonderful person. Well, I was appearing in a play at school. I went to Beverly Hills High School. And I was the star of the play. And Florence Henderson felt bad because she couldn't come, because she was appearing at the Sands Hotel in Las Vegas. So she got a program, which I still have, a big menu from the Sands, and she signed it for me, and she had all of her friends sign it. So, like, Burt Reynolds signed it and Bob Newhart signed it and all these things. Aww. Wishing me luck on my play.
Wow.
Isn't that neat?
So you don't have 6 degrees of separation. You have 1 degree of separation.
With her,
and
yeah.
Zero. For a lot of people, it's really...
She introduced me to everybody. It was so nice of her. Like, she appeared on the Kate Smith Show. And Kate Smith, for those of you who don't know, was a big star in radio. I mean, actually big. And she was the original God Bless America. She sang God Bless America. Mm-hmm. And she was also a really talented blues singer and wonderful before she became a pop singer. And she introduced Abbott and Costello to the American audience. Kate Smith did.
Wow.
So I got a chance to meet Kate Smith. It was really a thrill. And she introduced me to Jack Parr, who signed
Incredible.
My book. Yeah. She
you
introduced
have to
me.
Touch you.
Yeah. She introduced me to Johnny Carson. And then Johnny Carson introduced me to Lucille Ball, who was sitting there. And I there I was looking at Lucille Ball. And I said, wow, it sure is an honor to meet you. And she goes, it's a pleasure to meet you, young man.
Wow. That is much more interesting than most of our lives. Like I said, I love living vicariously through you.
Yeah.
So we're going to pivot to another little excerpt, which I think relates.
Okay.
Okay? So this is someone you really like. I'm just going to play this, and then you're going to tell us all about this man who I wish was my uncle and was at every family event.
Oh, that's Orson Bean. Do you remember your first game show?
Yes, it was I've Got a Secret, and I didn't have a clue because playing games on a game show is a very specific skill. It's a minor one, but a specific one. Being a good game show panelist is like being a virtuoso of the kazoo. And I didn't know what the hell I was doing, and I lasted 2 shows, and they fired me.
Really?
Yeah, but I was on the very first I've Got a Secret, and the second, and that was all. And then after a while, they gave me another shot on a show called Password, and by that time I had figured out how to do it. And then subsequently I went on to Tell the Truth, and they kept me on there for 7 years, and I sat between Kitty Carlisle and Peggy Cass, whom I used to call the ward healer's daughter. Kitty was so elegant with her feather boas, and Peggy was just such a, you know, an Irish gutter snipe that it was wonderful casting. They cast the panel the way you would cast a sitcom. So it wasn't just people answering questions. It was like kind of an odd, dysfunctional family, whether it was What's My Line that was quite intellectual with publishers and things.
Mm-hmm.
John Daly hosted it, and
Bennett
Cerf, mm-hmm. The publisher, and And there was Dorothy Kilgallen, whom America tuned in to love to hate. The people despised her. She was vile. I don't know if she was vile in person, but her persona was vile.
Did you know her? Did you meet her?
Very slightly, but I mean, you love to hate her the way you love to hate Simon Cowell on American Idol, you know.
Tell us about this wonderful man.
Or Orson Bean. It was such a great opportunity for me to chat with him. I met him. Tom Lehrer was invited to this Hungry Eye reunion up in San Francisco. And Tom Lehrer is a friend of mine. And he wasn't going to go because he's Tom Lehrer. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, you should go and I'll drive you. You know, in other words, please take me. And he did, and I got an opportunity to meet Ronnie Schell, who then was later on my show. Ronnie Schell was a comedian, actor. He played Gomer Pyle's best friend, and he also was a regular on That Girl. So Ronnie Schell was on two different networks, two different shows in the same season. And I met Shelley Berman, the great monologist comedian, who signed my album for me, and I got a chance to talk with him and his wife. Mort Saul was there, signed an album for me. Here I came with a bunch of things. And Orson Bean. It was really a dream come true to just talk with him. And I always found him to be humorous and wonderful. He was an actor, but he was best known, I think, as a ubiquitous television personality in the 60s. He was on The Tonight Show 99 times or something, and he was the host of The Tonight Show often. And he was a magician. He could do silly magic tricks. And he was on all these game shows. And I asked him if he would be on my show, and he said, absolutely. And we recorded that interview. I'm so glad we did it. He passed away a couple of years ago.
Yeah, he's funny. He's fun.
Oh, it's so great.
Right?
Yeah.
It's a real dream. Wish he was my uncle.
He's a really, really lovely guy. Funny guy. I asked him if, you know, he thought he would be sacrificing his acting career to appear on game shows. And he said, oh, yeah. But he goes, because then at that time, actually, he was about to begin a recurring role on Desperate Housewives. He said, now nobody remembers the game show, so I can act again.
He can go back.
Yeah.
We're going to do one more song.
Okay.
Because you got my curiosity going.
Okay.
Here's one more song. And we'll
you can cut out all my boring parts later.
It's usually my boring parts I cut out. All right, here we go.
You never close your eyes anymore. When I kiss your leaves, and there's no tenderness like before in your fingertips. You're trying hard not to show
it, baby.
But baby.
Tell us about this song.
Bill Medley. So that's not the original version. That's some Bill Medley later version of it, but it's a great, great record. The original song, You've Lost That Lovin' Feeling by the Righteous Brothers, was recorded in 1965, 66, and it was produced by Phil Spector. And it is the most played record in the history of AM radio.
I think the Righteous Brothers version.
The Righteous Brothers version. And when I played it, when I had him on my show. I had Bill Medley on the show. And I said, okay, that was the 1,000,000,001 time that it was played. But yeah, he's a terrific guy. It was a wonderful conversation with him. And it was lovely talking to him. And the Righteous Brothers had several great hits. And they were actually kind of more of a rock and roll band originally before that became their signature tune. And Bill Medley wrote a great book, and he still performs often. He's one of those Branson, Missouri guys that performs mm-hmm. there. I had Andy Williams on the show once, no longer living, but Andy Williams was one of the kings of Branson, Missouri.
There.
My favorite song of his was Can't Get Used to Losing You, and I told him that, and he goes, oh, I don't like that song. I hate that song. And I said, oh, did you ever hear the English beat version? He goes, yeah, I hate that more. He also told me that, Andy Williams told me that he didn't want anybody to ever record Moon River, like one of the most recorded songs in history. He says, that's my song.
It's all his. Well, You interview historians and sports historians and...
I've had a lot of great historians
comedians,
on the show.
Yeah.
David McCullough was on.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. It was so great to hear him talking in my ear, the voice, you know, that you hear so often on PBS. Many great historians have been on, and columnists. I had Pete Hamill on the show. I had so many great people. It's really been wonderful. And I was telling you that everyone who's ever been on my show has either died or will die. And when they do pass, it's really a treasure to be able to say, oh, listen back.
Right.
I've got this wonderful Patricia Bosworth, who was on my show a couple of times, and we became friends. And she was one of the first casualties of COVID, and I was like shocked that I wasn't going to be speaking with her again. But fortunately, I have these wonderful recordings with her. She's a terrific person.
Wow. And so if people want to catch more of these stories, they need to pay attention, because you're on every other week right now on KSQD 90.7 FM. So in 2023, what shows are you looking for? How about you tell us about your next show?
I've got some really good people scheduled and coming on. I have Tom Santapietro, who is a marvelous historian of American popular culture. He's just written a book about The Way We Were, the movie with Robert Redford and Barbara Streisand. He's an authority on Streisand. And I've got Charles Elton, who wrote a book about Michael Cimino, the great film director who directed Heaven's Gate and Deer Hunter. I've got some singer-songwriters coming. I've got a lot of great things. Always got stuff going. And I have Jesse Green. He's the chief theater critic of the New York Times and the author of a wonderful book, The Memoir of Mary Rogers, the daughter of Richard Rogers. But the memoir was written not by Mary Rogers, but by Jesse Green. But it's a really great book. It's called Shy. That's one of my favorite books of this. Of 2022.
All right.
So a lot of good things
going. A lot to look forward to.
Yeah.
And again, if people want to catch your show, it's on live every other week. So you need to pay attention and check the schedule at ksqd.org, or they can just catch you podcasting. Are these on
FromTheBookshelf.com?
That's the best.
And
way
you can subscribe at wherever you subscribe to podcasts, like Apple Podcasts, for instance. Mm-hmm. And then like five of them will download to your phone. And while you're driving around town, you can listen to me.
You can just listen to them one after the other. Well, thank you so much for joining me on Talk of the Bay, Gary.
Thank you for having me. Really appreciate it.
It's been a pleasure. This has been Talk of the Bay on KSQD Santa Cruz, your community radio station for the Central Coast.